Hello and welcome to episode 29 of the Ecuador Insider Podcast. I'm Jesse Bayer, joined as always by my business partner, Darnell Dunn. We have an amazing guest for you today who we'll get to momentarily. Today is Wednesday, March 29th. Haven't come to you guys in a couple of weeks. Been just incredibly busy and haven't found a time to schedule it in, but here we are. We're just a few days in front of election season, the election, the runoff election here on April 2nd. So next time you hear from us, it'll probably be a fun show. We'll be riled up one way or another post Sunday, which on April 2nd when the election is. Again, we are Abundant Living Ecuador. You can find us at our website at A as in Apple, B as in Boy, Ecuador.com. 800 number from the States and Canada, 888-999-0948. And of course, info at abecuador.com. Also, check us out on YouTube, Facebook, etc. We put out a lot of content and a lot of information. If you're looking to research Ecuador or maybe you're in Ecuador and you're looking for information about it, that's something we really try to do through our blogs and through all the social media stuff, YouTube included. So let's get right to it. We are joined today by Olivier Wagner, and I'm really excited because he is an expert in a field that I would say most people living abroad are very undereducated about, myself included. He is a CPA, and he is the managing director of 1040 Abroad. You can find that at 1040abroad.com. He's a French, born in France, and his dream was to travel worldwide, which he's done, and become a true sort of global citizen. He moved to the United States after completing his master's in finance as well as an MBA. worked on Wall Street and passed two levels of the CFA exam. He now is somebody who is really an expert on tax returns for those living abroad or those with assets abroad, and also has found quite a niche in the space for those renouncing citizenship. He is currently in Georgia. You're going to have to help me, Olivier, with how to pronounce the city you're in. He's currently in Georgia. Say again.
The city is Tbilisi.
I'm not even going to try to repeat it. He traveled to 30 different countries in 2016. So really interesting person and with a lot of amazing information. So Olivier, thank you so much for being here. Darnell, you as well. How's it going today?
Going good. Thank you for having me.
Excellent. So let's just jump right into it. I guess maybe we could just start with a little background on you. I gave a little piece of your bio, but your story is a lot deeper. Why don't you just give us a quick sort of rundown of how you ended up where you are?
So I was born in France. I grew up there until I was 24 years old. In 2004, I moved to the U.S. I worked at Moody's, the credit rating agency in New York. And in 2011, so I spent 7 years in the U.S. I became a U.S. citizen. In 2011, I moved to Montreal. So my wife was American. She's no longer my wife. She had a job as professor in Montreal. Once in Montreal, I started working in U.S. taxation, so preparing returns for Canadians doing business in the U.S. as well as U.S. citizens living in Canada. And last year, when the fall 2015, I flew to Bangkok, Thailand, to attend a conference. I stayed there for almost 6 months in and out. And then I traveled in Europe, a little bit in the Americas. That's my story. I'm a French citizen, U.S. citizen. I'm still technically a permanent resident of Canada, even though I'll lose it sooner or later. And I'm a permanent resident of Georgia going for citizenship.
Okay. And you got it, you sort of, I mean, the majority of your business currently is for U.S. citizens living, doing business abroad and those renouncing citizenship. Is that correct?
Yes, it's about 50% annual filers filing their returns every year, and 50% people filing 5 years at once to become compliant and then renouncing U.S. citizenship.
Okay. So why don't we, I mean, I want to get into FATCA. I want to get into reporting requirements and, you know, pitfalls and advice. But why don't we start with just the renouncing stuff? Because that's something a lot of people are interested in. A lot of people who leave the U.S. In part are doing so because of the sort of crazy tax policy and, you know, some of the FATCA rules, etc. So if somebody actually wants to, you know, renounce their U.S. citizenship, they've obviously established, you know, residency elsewhere, and they can, you know, get citizenship elsewhere. What is the requirements for that on the U.S. side?
So, I mean, immigration-wise, you would need an appointment at the consulate. Well, there's two ways to relinquish your citizenship. So you can either renounce, which is the easiest way to do it. You get an appointment at the U.S. consulate. You pay a fee of $2,350. And then you will get, about 6 months later, a certificate of loss of nationality. Mm-hmm. But to stop being in the U.S. tax system, you need to file a final return and file form 8854. And then tax-wise, there's two types of expatriate, covered and uncovered. And there are some penalties for being covered. And in order to not be covered, one of the requirements is to have been compliant for the prior 5 years. They don't need to have been timely filed, but they need to have been filed. So that's why I have a lot of accidental Americans, people who were almost oblivious to the fact that they were American. Mm-hmm. And so they have never filed U.S. tax returns. So they would file 5 years at once and then renounce.
Okay, so basically, there's a $2,300, the $2,350 fee. There's some forms that you'd have to file, and you've got to be tax compliant for the last 5 years.
Yes, so that's for the renunciation. The renunciation occurs when you show up at the consulate and you take an oath saying that you don't want to be a U.S. citizen, and then they accept. Another way is to relinquish. So you can relinquish by performing several acts, whether it's working for a foreign government, working for a foreign army, acquiring a foreign citizenship. Mm-hmm. And then if the Department of State, so you will perform these acts.
Yeah.
You perform this act with the intent of renouncing U.S. citizenship. The U.S. recognized dual citizenship. You can acquire a second citizenship that will not affect your U.S. citizenship unless you do it with the intent of relinquishing it. And a few decades ago, the onus was on you to prove that you really wanted to remain American. These days, it's the other way around. You really have to prove that you wanted to relinquish if that was the case. The more draconian rules on relinquish your citizenship starting in 2004. So if you can have an expatriating event before 2004 and have a case to say that you did it without with the intent of renouncing U.S. citizenship, which means that you didn't hold yourself as a U.S. citizen ever since, then you wouldn't need to worry about any of these rules.
One quick question, Olivier. Do you need to be a citizen of another country before renouncing your U.S. citizenship or renouncing citizenship of any other country?
Interestingly, no. There actually is a UN treaty against statelessness which says that the signing parties will not let anybody stateless, but the U.S. is not a party to this treaty and actually allows people to to become stateless. They strongly warn against it, but if that's your choice, you can do that. Somebody else, the website nostate.com, and did exactly that, and is quite strongly against the U.S. government. It's an interesting website. It's more for entertainment than for legal advising purposes, but you can check it out, nostate.com.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, super. And what are you seeing as far as trends? I mean, when I look at statistics, I see that the number of folks renouncing is growing by hundreds, if not thousands of percent year over year, although the raw numbers are still pretty low. What are you seeing as far as trends in that direction?
Yeah, I'm seeing the same thing. That's... Yeah, I just see an increase, and yeah, I don't really see the demand ending soon. With FATCA, the U.S. government will have knowledge of U.S. citizens' assets in foreign countries that they were supposed to report, both on the FR and forms going with the tax return. And so the fear of penalties or trying to prove your status with the bank can push somebody to renounce U.S. citizenship. I actually had a client, so Switzerland was actually in the forefront of that because historically it was a tax haven, it's not anymore. Mm-hmm. But the Department of Justice considered that if you're a Swiss bank, you're guilty until proven innocent. So, yeah, so this bank in this particular case froze 50% of my client's assets and would only release it once he filed U.S. tax returns. So that was a drastic step. I don't really see it usually, and banks in Switzerland were more aggressive than otherwise. But you have this sort of questioning coming from banks, and that pushes people to renounce. And the IRS is still collecting FATCA data, but pretty soon they will be sending letters to people with bank accounts which were not reported with their tax returns.
Okay. And give people just a quick sense of...
Yeah, that's it for me for now.
Sorry. I had muted out there for a second because I was typing something and I started talking, but you couldn't hear me. Give people a quick sense of... Sorry. We got something crazy going on outside. Gives people a quick sense of... What are the FATCA requirements? So if I'm, for example, you know, I'm a U.S. citizen, I'm living in Ecuador, I've got bank accounts, you know, I've got real property, etc. What do I actually have to do? What is the parameters?
Okay, so by way of background, before FATCA, there were FBAR rules which were actually signed into law in the 1970s, but... FinCEN only really started enforcing them in 2003. So it said that if you had more than $10,000 in foreign bank accounts, you had to file an FBAR form, currently mm-hmm. called FinCEN 114. With FinCEN, it actually does not go to the IRS. It's another branch of the Treasury Department. So if you have more than $10,000 in a foreign bank account, you would have to file an FBAR. And then, for some reason, instead of doing an information sharing between these two branches of the Treasury, as part of FATCA, the IRS created Form 8938. Mm-hmm. And it includes foreign bank accounts, but it also includes other sorts of assets. So for a single person living in the U.S., the filing threshold is at $50,000. For a single person living outside the U.S., that would be $200,000. So the assets to be reported are bank accounts, trusts, other securities if you own shares or bonds directly, not within an account, that would have to be reported on an 1838, but not on the FBAR form. So if you own a foreign corporation, that would also be a reportable asset. The two main carved-out exceptions are real estate. If you own real estate in a foreign country, that does not need to be reported. Also, precious metals, gold, silver, do not have to be reported, but safe deposit boxes do. So if you leave your metal in a safe deposit box, then you still have to report it. There is a firm in Singapore which actually is in the business of storing gold, but they're not a bank.
Yeah.
So they found this little niche to help people, to safeguard people's gold without having them have to report it on Form 1838.
Yeah, that kind of defeats the purpose of a safety deposit box if you're telling the U.S. government the contents of it. Okay, that's very clear. Darnell, you got anything else on FATCA?
FATCA, yes. Olivier, could you talk a little bit about the foreign earned income tax exemption for people who are living abroad?
Right, so the foreign earned income exclusion is it's separate from FATCA. It's one of the two main benefits that the IRS or the Internal Revenue Code gives to Americans living abroad. So now you need to meet one of the two tests to qualify for the foreign earned income exclusion. One is the bona fide residence test, and that means that you truly live somewhere. Mm-hmm. So my interpretation is that you need to at least spend 6 months a year that country, and then you need to have ties. You must be a tax resident of that country. If that country does not have an income tax system, it's okay as long as they would otherwise have jurisdiction to tax you. And yeah, so any ties would be useful if you have a local driving license, you own real estate, you're working for a local company, you're speaking the language. All of these ties would help you prove that you meet the bona fide residence test. So it's a test that's a little subjective, but the minimum, I would say, is to spend 6 months in that country, not claim to be a non-resident to the authorities of that country and be subject to income tax if an income tax system exists. The second test is the physical presence test, for which you need to spend at least 330 days in any 12-month period in a foreign country. So it's much more objective. You know where you are. It needs to be in a foreign country, so international water does not count. Going to Cuba against the embargo does not count either. So, and it can be any 12-month period. You can go from April 12, 2016 to April 11, 2017. That is one 12-month period. So if your 12-month period does not cover the full calendar year, you would prorate the maximum you can exclude. So using the foreign earned income exclusion, as the name indicates, you can exclude foreign earned income. So that's only for wages, self-employment income. It is not for passive income or other kinds of income. And the maximum you can exclude is $102,000 in 2016. And on top of that, there's a foreign housing exclusion, which is rarely useful because the first $40 per day don't count. So you really need to spend a lot in rent or housing expense for that to work.
Okay.
Yeah, so if all of your income comes from earned income, wages, or self-employment income, and it's less than $102,000, you want to make sure to meet one of these two tests to exclude that income, and then you won't have to pay tax on it.
And just to clarify for people, so, and Olivier, please correct me here, the U.S. is one of like one or two countries in the world that has the double taxation on foreign income?
So, well, it's not double taxation. Oftentimes, my clients wouldn't actually have to pay anything. They just have this huge filing requirement.
Okay.
What it is that it's only the U.S. and Eritrea, which is a tiny country in Africa next to Djibouti.
Mm-hmm.
These are the only two countries in the world which tax their citizens wherever they live. So when I left Canada, at first I was a Canadian resident because that was my true residence. I left, I filed a form with the Canadian authorities, making a case showing that I had ties somewhere else and I no longer had ties to Canada. They agreed with me. They sent a letter saying that I was non-resident.
Mm-hmm.
And being a non-resident, I only had to pay tax on Canadian sourced income, not worldwide income. And that would apply to a Canadian citizen as well, that in most developed countries, well, all developed countries in one way or another, they tax their residents on worldwide income and non-residents on income sourced in that country. The U.S. sees their U.S. citizen as being resident regardless of where they live. So if they are a resident somewhere else, then they can, they will still have to report income on their worldwide income in both countries. By and large, they pay the highest tax rates of the two. So one way to avoid U.S. tax is the foreign earned income exclusion, for which you don't actually need to pay tax somewhere else. You just need to be, well, you need to be liable under the bona fide residence test. You don't even need that for the physical presence test.
Mm-hmm.
The other way is the foreign tax credit. If you live in a country with a tax rate which would be greater than the U.S., which a lot of my clients do, then you could claim a one-to-one credit for every dollar of tax you paid to that foreign country, and you can offset taxes related to any kind of income, not just earned income. You can offset taxes related to capital gains, dividends, other income. As long as that's sourced in that other country, you can claim the foreign tax credit in the U.S.
Okay. Darnell, I had a question that was related but a little different. Do you want to follow up anything we're on right now?
No, go ahead, continue, please.
Okay. So then Olivier, what are some of the loopholes? What are the tricks? What can people do if I'm outside of the US? I don't want to deal with the U.S. paying taxes in the U.S., of course. I want to minimize my tax burden, but I'm going to make money where I am. I'm going to have assets. What are the tricks? What do you recommend people do to obviously stay compliant, but, you know, minimize their tax burden and minimize their reporting, you know, their reporting requirement costs and so forth? What sort of structure do you sort of recommend to people to, protect their assets from taxes?
So as far as income tax is concerned, there's these two vehicles, the foreign tax credit, foreign earned income exclusion. So if you don't actually pay that much tax to a foreign country, you want to be extremely sure that you will meet one of the two foreign earned income exclusion tests. Another aspect is social security or self-employment tax. And if you're self-employed in a country which doesn't have a totalization agreement with the U.S., and these are developed countries, OECD countries, I don't think that Ecuador, well, I'm pretty sure Ecuador does not, I don't have to look it up, Ecuador does not have a totalization agreement with the U.S. So if you're self-employed in Ecuador, you will have to pay self-employment tax. So that's the version of Social Security that is applicable to people. And if you are an employee of a U.S. corporation, I don't know why you will do that. They would also withhold Social Security. But if you are an employee of a foreign corporation, an Ecuadorian corporation, or from somewhere else, you would not have to pay Social Security. So one loophole would be to create a corporation and be your own employee. You can be an employee of a corporation you own, and you still would not have to pay neither self-employment nor Social Security tax. But you would have to incur the compliance cost of running that company. So first, with regards to the local authorities, then you would also need to file Form 5471 with your tax return. So I would advise that structure when somebody's income is upward of $50,000 a year. Mm-hmm. If your income is less than that, you might as well simply pay the self-employment tax.
Okay. Anything else on that theme before we move on as far as tips, advice for people who have assets overseas or are working overseas?
Yeah. One more question, Jesse. So I know, Olivier, that you had mentioned that you're a citizen of the U.S. and France and Georgia and a permanent resident in Canada. How has your background in finance and as a CPA informed your decisions about where you live, where you work, and where you hold assets? Hello?
Yes, I'm thinking about it. I still have the business decision of having bank accounts in the US and Canada to serve my clients. And speaking about that, even if you want to run a foreign corporation but you have clients in the US, you can create an LLC owned by that foreign corporation, and that would give you access to the US banking system. Because unless you're going to deposit $1 million in your new bank account, a US bank will not open an account for a foreign corporation. But they will do that for a Wyoming LLC, which for tax purposes would be a disregarded entity, so would be the same as the owner being the foreign corporation in this case. So, I don't really push for to have my assets in tax havens. I still have them in safe places, these US, Canada.
Okay, great.
Yeah. The structure I mentioned will address the tax aspect of things, and you want the place where you have your bank accounts or other assets to be economically and politically stable as well. But that does not need to be the US or Canada. It can be. Well, I'm not too familiar when it comes to Latin America, but Singapore, Hong Kong is also some people's favorites to bank, and their banking system is probably more stable than the U.S.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other places offshore that you recommend that clients hold assets?
I don't have anything off the top of my head, sorry.
No worries. Okay, Jesse, that's all I had on that topic.
Okay, so you mentioned Singapore, Hong Kong. Those are, Belize, for example, down here as well. And there's, of course, the more commonly or more traditionally used ones like St. Kitts and Nevis, etc., for, you know, both for housing corporations, doing banking, doing business. You know, you're somebody who's traveled a lot. You're somebody, obviously, who's very steeped in this world of, taxes and assets and finding the right, you know, balance internationally in terms of structure and where you're having everything. What are some of the countries you've been to? I know you were in Bangkok last year. What are some of the countries you've been to? What are some of the sort of things you've seen there that stand out to you that maybe would be interesting for people to hear? What are some of the maybe that you liked the best or didn't like? Or, you know, for example, you know, why are you in Georgia now? What can you share with what kind of insight can you give to our audience through some of your travels as far as, the pros and cons of various places?
I like places which have enough infrastructure for me to work, but still have enough charm to be appealing, at least to my taste. So Bangkok, Thailand, as opposed to Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, would be, I think they both have great infrastructure, but Bangkok is a little bit more run down, and I find some charm in that, whereas Kuala Lumpur, and I imagine Singapore as well, is full of clean skyscraper, clean streets, and I don't find as much charm in that. Mm-hmm. I took a cruise in the Caribbean in December, so I visited a lot of countries with, I love the mud bath in Santa Lucia. I went to the Bassin Bleu next to Jacmel. It was not tax season. It was actually December when people don't really have in mind your citizenship. So it will add more of a tourism aspect to it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going back to the previous point. You mentioned the Caribbean. I think these have more. They're closer to the U.S., they have more U.S. clients, and they're more on the radar of the U.S. government. So if I think the banks there will be more FATCA compliant, they will interrogate their clients more. So if somebody's going to bank there, I would advise to clearly be tax compliant, whereas Georgia, where I'm now, would not be a place that would come off the top of U.S. government official if they know that it's a country and not just a state when it comes to looking into tax haven. I'm actually only a permanent resident of Georgia now. It should take me another 2 months to get citizenship. That was clarification I wanted to make.
Yeah. That is a really interesting point. So you're saying that some of the Caribbean countries like St. Kitts and Nevis, maybe Belize is on that, are going to be more on the radar of the U.S. government, whereas some of the others, like, for example, Georgia, as you mentioned, wouldn't be. That's accurate?
Yes, that's accurate. So you want to balance these tax requirements and just doing business. Getting a credit card merchant account in Belize or some other place will probably be easier than in Georgia. So if you're receiving your money through international wire transfer, then Georgia is a good place to bank. But if you need your credit card merchant account, then you might want Belize or some place with an even better banking system.
Mm-hmm. And one more question sort of along those lines. If I'm not mistaken, and you sort of covered this, so I'm I think it's pretty clear, but if I'm not mistaken, even if you, so for example, if you have a corporation or, you know, there's a corporation that owns a corporation, whatever it is, but if you have assets, it doesn't matter if it's in a corporation, doesn't matter how you're sort of what ownership structure you use. With FATCA, you know, you have to report those assets. I know you said there were some exceptions with real estate and with gold and things like that, but is there any sort of model that's legal that works that somebody could, you know, have an enterprise, be a U.S. citizen, have an enterprise overseas, and through some sort of corporate structure or holding company or trust or whatever, actually not have the U.S. government be aware of those activities. Again, I'm not speaking to hide money or to, you know, or to not be tax compliant. I just mean literally awareness.
No, not really. The ways to do that legally would be to not own the corporation. So if you have a non-grantor trust and you don't, you cannot direct the money within that trust, it's not your asset anymore. So whatever this trust owns, you do not have to report it. Likewise, if your spouse, who is not a US citizen, owns a corporation, you might be an employee of that corporation or whatever your agreement is. But since it's not your corporation, you won't have to report it. But if you actually own a corporation, you will have to report it. Not just on the 18 and 38, but more importantly on Form 5471.
Okay. Wow, this is such incredibly valuable information, Olivier. Darnell, what we can sort, if you want, we can make this a little bit shorter episode and then maybe dive into the election for a few minutes after we let Olivier go. But I definitely want to flesh everything out if there's anything that we've missed. Do you have more stuff as far as, you know, renunciation or taxes or international citizen? Oh, you know what? In fact, while I'm talking, Olivier, you probably, I would imagine, have some experience, or obviously you do personally, but perhaps some business experience as well in the whole, you know, second passport idea. Do you have, and I know maybe this isn't your business directly, but do you have recommendations for people as far as, you know, what countries are the best to, do the second passport? Obviously, you know, there's some ones that, you know, people are familiar with, like Panama. I mean, even Ecuador is a pretty easy one. And then there's some like pay to play, you know, investment passport countries where you can get them really quick, but the price tag on that can be really high. It sounds like you're getting it really quick in Georgia. I've heard of Georgia as a good place. Do you have any thoughts around that?
Yes. So Georgia is a little under the radar. I had contacts for that. The conditions are getting more stringent as time goes on. Citizenship by investment goes with an investment of about $250,000 in Caribbean countries. If you really just want a passport, any kind of passport will do. The Comoros has a citizenship by investment program for $45,000. But it's a Comoros, it's an African passport, it's totally legitimate if you go through the citizenship investment program. $45,000, you get a Comorian passport, and you can travel to a few places, which actually include Malaysia and Indonesia visa-free, so it's not completely useless, but it's, I wouldn't renounce U.S. citizenship to travel on just a Comorian passport. I'm just putting it out there.
I think that's a safe statement.
It's not completely useless.
right. Like, the good I can say about it is it's not completely useless. That's funny.
It's a passport. It's legitimate.
Yeah.
If you bribe somebody and then they cancel your passport or whatever, or if your question as to, oh, you got it, you could go to jail. Well, this one is legitimate. It's
right.
A passport.
Right.
So, yeah. So, that's a passport.
Right. Anything else, Darnell? Or Olivier?
No.
Before we wrap up, anything that we haven't covered?
No, we can wrap up.
Yeah, that was all I had.
Okay. Olivier, before we let you go, please let me give you a few minutes to plug your business. So I gave the website at the beginning. You're welcome to do so again. How can people get in touch with you? Plug anything you want. Time is yours.
Yes, so I operate 1040 abroad, 1040abroad.com. So you can just go on my website, contact me, and I prepare tax returns, an annual tax return for $400. an FBAR for $100. Or if you have any other question, just go to the contact form on my website, contact me, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours.
Very good. Olivier, I am really, really grateful to you for coming on the show. I think, honestly, this might have been, you know, maybe the best value of any show that we've brought for our listeners. This is a subject that, you know, nobody ever wants to talk about because it's scary and no one knows anything about it. So really, thank you so much for taking the time and for being so knowledgeable. You're clearly an expert in what you do. And, you know, I very much appreciate your time.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Thanks again, Olivier.
Okay. Darnell, did you want to jump in, maybe do 10, 15 minutes on the election in the last couple of weeks, or should we save that for next week?
Up to you. I'm ready to talk about the election if you are. Maybe we can, maybe we'll reach a couple of people who might be able to vote in the election and we can get out the vote a little bit.
All right, cool. Let's do it. So just to give people a little background, we had actually recorded a show, you know, maybe, I don't know, it was, I think it wasn't last week, actually. I think it was 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago. Maybe even 2.5 or 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, so that didn't get recorded properly, so we couldn't put it out. It was unfortunate. It was a fun show, and we sort of, we basically spent the whole, you know, hour, whatever it was. It was just me and Darnell just sort of recapping the events of the election and just talking about the election and so forth. And, you know, I mean, let's say you're an American and you just went through the Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton show over the last couple of years, culminating in election. You know, it's funny, in Ecuador, it's a much smaller deal. It's a much much smaller thing here. That being said, it's fascinating. It has its ups and downs. So I'm going to take like 30 seconds to 2 minutes and just recap for people what took place with the first round of the election. And then maybe we can jump in for a minute, you know, sort of what's at stake in the election that's coming up here on April 2nd. So and you know, this is I'm not prepared for this. This was a few weeks ago, so you know, this won't be 100% accurate, only 98%, but more or less what happened. So set this thing up. We had, you know, we had Lenin Moreno, the vice president, former vice president of Rafael Correa, who's an open socialist. We had Guillermo Lasso, who's a former banker, businessman. Those were the first and second candidates, and then some more after that. Moreno needed to get to 40% of the vote for there not to be a runoff. Darnell, you probably remember the date. Do you remember the date of what this what the first round was?
I think the first round was, oh, you know what? I don't.
Wow, that's surprising coming from you.
You caught me off guard.
Yeah. So maybe, you know, it was about 3 weeks ago, something like that. So 3-4 weeks ago, max. Moreno had to get to, or someone, which would have been Moreno, had to get to 40% for there not to be a runoff, and win by 10 points. So if he was at 40% or more and 10 points ahead of the second place guy, he wins. As you guys know who have listened to the show, Darnell and I are very much not in favor of Moreno, you know, the socialist candidate. We're not going to dive into all of that. It's just our opinion. You can like it or not like it, and that's totally fine with us. So we were, you know, I'll just speak for myself. So I'm in Guayaquil at the time, and it's election day. They do it on Sunday. They have this 3-day, I think it's 3 days, 3 or 4 day dry law where, you know,
it starts Friday at 12.
Friday at 12, right.
Counting.
Right. Where you can't drink, so no one can buy, you know, no one can buy booze during that time. And then
Hang on one second.
Go ahead.
I just have to tell this funny story here. So I'm heading out with some clients to Tarqui, which is a town about 20 minutes away from, 20 minutes south of Cuenca. So I'm there we're riding out in a taxi with some clients going to look at a property, and I'm chatting with the taxi driver, and he says, you know, like, let's go Lasso. Like, we're having a whole political conversation. It was funny. And then he was like, yeah, so the dry law starts, you know, Friday at 12, so make sure you go on Thursday night to go buy liquor. I said, thank you. Because I didn't know exactly what time it was, if I needed to go, you know, if I could go on Friday or if I needed to go Thursday. So it was pretty funny. Anyway, I digress. Go ahead.
Giving you the heads up. So the election, basically they started releasing the exit polls around 5 o'clock, a few minutes before 5 o'clock, and they were very scary. The first one that was released had Moreno at like 44-46% and you know, 10 points more, comfortably 10 points ahead. Then the subsequent ones had them much closer. One had Moreno at 38, 36, one had him at 40, 41, 42. So I realized within like 10, 15 minutes of, you know, I'm flipping channels and my heart's, you know, my heart's my stomach's in my chest or my throat. You know, I'm realizing, oh my God, this is going to come down to the wire. Like, he's going to be right around 40% and he's going to be right around 10 points ahead. And so the night's playing out, it was really interesting because, you know, we live in this digital world where, you know, the internet is so prevalent and everybody's connected all the time and information gets shared so fast. So, you know, I'm sort of I've got the TV on and I should be working, but you know, I'm very caught up in it. I've got the TV on and I've got my phone and my computer, and some the government has a website, you know, much like you would get in the States or elsewhere, where they're tabulating the vote and you can refresh it and follow the vote. And when the first tabulations came out, it was looked really good from our perspective. Lasso was within like 6 or 7 points and Moreno was at like 30, you know, 6% or something. And so, but as the night went on, as the vote came in, that lead was growing and growing and growing. And then it became clear that it was going to be more than 10 points. And so the only question was, is he going to get to 40 or not? And you know, at one point the website crashed. Who knows what really happened, but the website crashed of the government company that, or the CNE, the election, you know, result.
You don't say.
Right. And so, you know, nobody could see the vote. Everyone was going crazy. And then all of these videos surfaced. I mean, hundreds of them, of these videos surfaced of fraud, of what looked like pretty widespread fraud, ballots arriving already marked for the Alianza País party, the socialists, ballots in the trash of Guillermo Lasso, the pens with disappearing ink, where people were...
That Correa himself warned you about in a video before he was first elected.
Oh, that's funny. We have to get into that, yeah. Do you want to do that now or do you want to do that after?
We can do it after. Go ahead.
Okay.
You're rolling. Go ahead.
Okay. The disappearing ink, the trash, the arriving already marked, and then there was all lots and lots of evidence of people with multiple... So the way it works here is if you're registered to vote, which everybody is, because you get fined if you don't vote, which certainly helps the socialist cause. But if you're registered to vote, they have this book that has a card in it that has your picture on it, and when you show up to vote, you show them your ID and they rip out this card and you sign it, and then you're allowed to vote, and then you give them back, then they don't have the card anymore, so that tells them that you voted already, and that's how it works. But they had the same person in the book multiple times. For there was, you know, dead people, you know, lots and lots of dead people on the rolls, just lots and lots of evidence. And it was really funny. I love Ecuador, man. I love just like how it is here. It's like guys were like in parks outside of where you vote, and people were like, what's in the bag? You know, what's in the bag? The bag gets ripped open. There's all these vote ballots in there already filled out, you know, hundreds if not thousands of ballots, and they're screaming, and the crowd is around, and they're trying to call the cops, and the cops are looking at them like, what do you want? You know? and just all these scenes were playing out, mostly over social media. But then the news picked it up. And so over the next couple of days, the news picked up all these stories of the fraud, and I mean, it seemed like there was really widespread fraud. I don't even think the most ardent supporter of, you know, of Moreno would deny, you know, the evidence of fraud. So that was really interesting. And then the other thing that was really interesting to me is just how the people reacted. I mean, people took to the streets here in mass. I mean, in mass. I was saying to Darnell and others, like, I think if they just announced that Moreno won, they're going to have a revolution on their hands. I mean, people here are fed up. Like, people here do not want to continue with Rafael Correa and his policies. I mean, that's just true. And so the idea that Moreno not only you know, won the first round, but won the whole thing and won it by quite a handy margin, just didn't sit right with people as to their perception of what happened. And fraud here is so widespread in certain ways. It's so cultural. People are so used to it, and they're so used to, you know, taking matters into their own hands and kicking out presidents and, you know, et cetera. I mean, people took to the streets in mass, and it was such a show. It was so interesting to me to watch it. It reaffirmed my sort of love affair with Ecuadorians. But anyway, so that's sort of the recap. There's a lot more I could say, but I don't want to go on forever. The runoff is on April 2nd. Right now, the polls have Moreno, for the most part, leading by a little. How much you can trust those, who knows? And we'll see what happens. We should know Sunday or Monday, or if things really drag out, you know, a day or two after that.
It'll be really interesting to see. You know, there's been a lot of articles in the news about, you know, whether they're, you know, pro Moreno or pro Lasso. You know, I kind of noticed a trend because I'm always following news on Ecuador and online, and I found that right after the runoff, all of the articles were about Lasso and how he made it to the second round and, you know, all these things that he planned to do for Ecuador and how positive it might be, especially for investors. And the last couple of weeks, it's kind of gone the other way, where it's been all about Moreno and all about how Lasso may or may not have accounts offshore. And, you know, there had been some legislation that was signed recently that Ecuadorian officials can't have assets offshore. A lot about what was the other thing that they were talking about? Yeah, essentially basically saying that, you know, he has all of his money overseas in tax havens, that he's still involved at in the business decisions and day-to-day decision-making at Banco de Guayaquil, where he worked for over 20 years, and that, you know, if he comes to power, you know, it's going to ruin Ecuador again, and there's going to be widespread corruption, and he's going to give, you know, big banks from overseas the green light to come into Ecuador and destroy the country, et cetera, et cetera. It's just interesting how people who feel that, you know, I mean, first of all, people in the United States, if you're talking about their politics, would be liberals, really. They're much more centrist or, you know, slightly leaning to the left than one would suspect, in my opinion. And also, in addition to that, it's just interesting that you're talking about corruption that might happen when there's lots of very high-ranking officials in Correa's party that are under investigation for widespread corruption with this Obrecht scandal.
Namely, all of them. No, I'm joking.
You've got a lot of them.
I mean, his vice president is on the top of that list.
Vice president. You've got one of his sisters is on the list.
Yeah.
You know, and all of this will come out after the election.
Right.
Some of it's already come out, but it'll come out in force after the election, no matter who wins, I think. So,
yeah.
All remains to be seen, but a lot of interesting cross currents and things that are being said, and it's crunch time. It's only a couple of days away.
You remember the Obama phone, you know, in 2000, 2008, I guess. They have the Obamacare,
remember? Yeah, Obama does care.
They have the equivalent of the Obama phone here. They have, and it's worse. They have peoples, and I've seen them, and there's hundreds of videos of it. They have people sitting on street corners in neighborhoods and in all over, telling people to sign up for Moreno houses houses. Yeah, so they've got hundreds of thousands of people signing up, and they're telling them if Moreno wins, he's gonna give you a house, apparently there's enough people stupid enough to believe that are actually signing up, because I've seen lines, long lines, and then of course the social media. You know, thank God for like people with cell phones who can like document stuff, because You know, they're finding these signatures for the houses in the trash all over Ecuador. So, you know, good luck with your Moreno house, but you know, hey, whatever works. You know, you talk. I mean, and this is legal. You know, this is legal. This is like, this is not fraud. This is okay. Like,
one question for you though, with the Obama phone. Was he already in office, or was that during election time?
I mean, I don't know. That was honestly like I was an Obama supporter at that time, very stupidly, and
Were you advocating for Obama phones?
No, but I wasn't paying attention. So like, I remember when that whole hullabaloo happened. I believe it was during the election, but I remember when that whole hullabaloo happened with, you know, basically the what people call the right in the States. Sort of going crazy about like, look, look at this ridiculous, ignorant, you know, people thinking they're going to get a cell phone from this guy and voting for him because of it. And I remember,
in his defense, they did produce the phones. My grandmother definitely had.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, that's it.
You told me that before, and like, I was dying. Like, that was the first I had heard of that. Like, I thought it was just like a fake thing, but apparently it wasn't.
I thought so too. My aunt was telling me about it. She was like, yeah, they got these phones. I'm like, what are you talking about? She showed it to me.
Oh, that's really funny.
I mean, it was like one of those Nokia phones. Remember the phones that we got from Movistar when we first got to Ecuador? Or maybe I just got the phone.
Yeah, I think, but yeah, I don't think I did.
Yeah, you wouldn't have had that.
So you mean the government issued phone wasn't that good?
Yeah. Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. That old Nokia phone that like they came out with in 98.
Yeah, like the one my dad still has. Like,
right.
No, I'm joking, but yeah.
That's the one that I bought here in Ecuador for $60 in 2013.
Yeah, right.
And those are the ones that they were giving away for the Obama phone.
Yeah. So I think that covers most of that. Let's jump in for a second, and maybe we've done this before. We'll keep it very brief. We'll wrap up here in a few minutes. But let's jump in and just really quick from my perspective, and Darnell, you know, jump in at any time. I know we share, you know, very similar views on this. But from my perspective, you know, let's just talk for a second about what's at stake here in the election.
Sure.
And, you know, I want to preface this with a caveat. You know, I'm a pro freedom person on all fronts at all times. I'm very, you know, I believe in the market and no liberals out there. I don't think that we had capitalism under George Bush. you know, I'm a voluntarist. You know, I'm an anarchist. I don't believe in control of any kind. I believe in voluntary exchange. You know, so I don't, not only do I, you know, believe in the market, but I believe in that across all fronts. So I don't believe in borders, you know, I don't believe in any of it. So, that's my perspective. And for a lot of people, that's very extreme and that's fine. So when I look at these two candidates on a lot of issues that are important to me on a personal level, for example, you know, policing, the whole idea behind having to get permissions and licenses for everything, you know, China sort of mining all over and being very indebted to China. A lot of these sorts of things, they're exactly the same one. So I'm not in favor of Lasso because he's going to create some voluntarist paradise, which, you know. So I just want to caveat. I just want to preface what I'm going to say with that, you know, I think both will be the same on those sorts of issues, which are things that are very important to me. Where I think the difference is if Lasso is elected, and no, this won't last because we still have a debt-based monetary system, and ultimately, you know, we all know how that goes, anyone who's familiar with that. If Lasso gets elected, Ecuador is going to have a boom for a number of years, and it's going to start with perception. Lasso gets elected, you're going to have articles in the Wall Street Journal, you're going to have articles all over saying, you know, Ecuador's open for business, because right now it isn't. So, and then wealthy Ecuadorians who have their money parked overseas are going to come back, investors are going to come in, private investors, you know, the small guys as well. And there's going to be a lot of capital in Ecuador, things are going to be really good for a period of time. If Moreno gets elected, I don't know exactly what's going to happen. I know certainly what I just said will not happen. That's clear. Perhaps it's status quo, which is not the end of the world, but not great either. Perhaps it's status quo, but the risk, if Moreno gets elected, is ultimately Venezuela. And, you know, there's a couple of things stopping that, namely that Ecuador doesn't have its own currency, so can't just print into oblivion like Venezuela has done. And secondarily, the brand of socialism here is a lot softer than the brand of socialism in Venezuela. You know, Chavez in his heyday was taking over, was making private companies public day by day and announcing them in front of 100,000 people crowds, you know, with his military hat on. We don't have that here.
I think it's called the beret.
Yes, a beret. Exactly. Exactly. You know, we don't have that here, so maybe we're okay for a period of time under Moreno. But
also the socialist sneaker yet.
Not yet. No, although we have the Ministerio de like Felicidad or something. That we have the Minister of Happiness here. Which, I mean, we have the Ministerio de Control del Poder del Mercado, like something like that. We have the Minister of Controlling the Power of the Market, and then we have Ministerio de Felicidad or something like that, the Minister of Happiness. I mean, if
we
that's not...
We have the Ministry of Economic and Social Inclusion.
Right, yeah, right. I mean, if this isn't George Orwell, you know, I don't know what it is. But anyway, so that's my take, Darnell. Throw your two cents in and we'll get out of here.
Yeah, one more thing about the Office of Economic and Social Inclusion. So when they're not open, does that mean that there's no economic and social inclusion going on?
Rowan's was a friend, a guy that works with us was joking, like, you know, the Ministerio de Felicidad or whatever it is. They're like, you know, they like do yoga, eat bananas, like, you know, like they're like, you know, they're very happy.
Well, I mean, I would be happy too if I got to do all those things and somebody else had to pay for it.
Yeah, right. Okay. Well, and that's the point. I mean, that's the problem in Ecuador right now is that everything is public sector, everything. And that ultimately leads to collapse. It's not, you know, I think a lot of liberals have this like sort of false idea that people who don't believe in huge, gigantic, mammoth government want inequality and want, you know, don't like poor people and are racist and, you know, all the other kind of stuff. And, you know, it's just number one, it's just false. It's just not true. But the thing is, how do we get there? There's nobody really. I mean, yeah, there's a few racists here and there, and there's a few people who are just jerks here and there and whatnot. But in general, everybody wants equality. Everybody wants, you know, justice. Everybody wants, you know, everybody to have opportunity, et cetera. The question is, how do we get there? And right now in Ecuador, you know, you could have – if you're working for the government in one of – you know, you have four other guys doing your same job. And none of you are actually doing anything. You people just sit around. They sign papers. They harass people. You know, you've got, you know, you want to do some simple thing. You go in. You need this paper. You need that paper. Go over here. Go over there. Go over there. Go over there. Go this. Do that. And then, you know, they're just paid. They just push paper around and make lots of money. And so it drains the economy for people who are producing nothing. And ultimately, people are hurting the economy because their only job is to drain the economy through time and money dealing with them. So, you know, that's the problem we have. And so if Moreno gets elected, you know, we're going to definitely have more of the same that way. If Lasso gets elected, you know, maybe we have less. He certainly says so. He's got 14 taxes he wants to cut, et cetera. But
yeah, in terms of what's at stake, Jesse, I mean, I think you hit the point on the head or hit the nail on the head. I would say about really with Venezuela, I think one thing that's helping is that people, you know, it's a very strong example. And it's close by. And lots of Venezuelans are coming to Ecuador. And so, you know, talking about their experiences. And so this is something, it's an example that's very close to home. And I think lots of people are looking at Venezuela and thinking, you know, Correa was very much aligned with the Venezuelan government throughout his tenure as president in Ecuador. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people, that's very clear to people, both supporters and detractors. And so I think that example is very strong for people. So, you know, we'll see how that impacts people when they get to the polls, because ultimately that's the only thing that matters. Yeah. In terms of my perspective on Lasso, obviously I support him. We've talked about that at length. But yeah, there's a lots of things that, and you touched on essentially all of them, that he's not going to change. And that's just a function of government in general, in my opinion.
Right.
So I'm not thinking that, you know, I'm not going to vote for him because I think he's going to change the world. I think that I'm voting for him because I think that in the short to intermediate term, that it's going to be, he's going to create a much more healthy environment for business. And that's one of the main things that we're doing here. And that's one of the main things that we're helping our clients do here. So I think that, you know, repealing those 14 taxes that he's talking about, including the 75% capital gains tax in the capital flight tax, will be real boons to the economy and to investing and, you know, creating lots of industry and production in Ecuador, which I think Ecuador, just where it's located, the fact that we're on the equator, that you have a very long growing season for lots of different things, and with the kinds of infrastructure that's been developed over the last 10 years, it just has all the prerequisites in place to really be one of Latin America's hottest investment destinations. So that's why I'm for it. It's really just that simple.
Yeah, I mean, agreed. And I mean, and people say, like, well, he's going to rob the country. I'm sure he is.
Yeah, like, I mean, that's what, but people don't understand, regardless of what side of the aisle they are on, that's a function of government.
Right, exactly.
Whatever, you're not going to find the government that doesn't rob. That's what governments do. They take what they don't produce. A government doesn't produce anything. So even the best government is going to be, it's an expense to the people at the end of the day. Yep. Now, whether that expense is worth it or not is another conversation. Right. But it's ultimately an expense. A government is not going to do something, anything that it takes in, it has to take from others. Yep. So just by definition, it's that way. So, you know, the things about the corruption and all this other stuff, to me, that's just par for the course. That's not something that I'm particularly focused on. Not to mention, that's not something that I can control and or monitor. I mean, where do we find out about corruption, quote unquote, on the news?
Right.
I don't have a mechanism, nor does anybody else who's outside of the government have a mechanism for monitoring or understanding corruption, other than the ones that are given to us. Right. And that's by design.
Yeah. And as you said, it's just par for the course. If you have an entity that has guys with guns, you know, the legal backing to do whatever they do, and they don't have any profit motive, you're going to end up in a situation 100% of the time where, you know, they're abusing their authority, period, end of story. So, you know, the idea that hundreds of millions of dollars or billions of dollars are going to get funneled through an entity that has the power of the sword, you know, has violence at their disposal, legal violence, has no profit motive. they can do whatever they want with that money. Whatever the results are doesn't change anything for them.
And if they need money, take more of it.
Right.
They go and borrow it from the, you know, they go into the bond market, they borrow it, and they stick you with the bill.
Right. So the idea that those people would be so moral, you know, so moral that they wouldn't, you know, they wouldn't do anything fraudulent or anything corrupt is laughable. I mean, it's laughable.
Especially when there's no recourse.
Exactly.
Who is going to, okay, I take this money, who's going to even know about it? Right. Nobody?
Right. And I mean, that doesn't even mention the fact, like, I'm sorry, guys, but politics doesn't attract virtuous people very often. And that's because it's power. You know, if you're after power, politics is a great, you know, it's a great avenue for you. And most people who are lusting for power are not super virtuous. So, you know, I mean, the head of the oil ministry in Ecuador, like, what's the chances of that guy being a virtuous human being? Like, you know, like,
and let's just say, for the sake of argument, that he is or was. Mm-hmm. Over time, being able to do what you want without any recourse,
right,
without any feedback that really matters.
Right.
I don't know. I think that's an influence that would, you know, that would corrupt somebody to a certain extent.
Absolutely.
And to the extent that, you know, they're being corrupted, you know, you're losing money because they're just taking, you know, they're stealing your labor.
Simple as that. Last thing I'll leave you with, and we got to get out of here, is it's so interesting to me how good they are here at class warfare.
They're very good everywhere at that. But
yes, that's
here
true.
Here they're pretty good
as
well.
It's a unique, though. It's different here. You're right. They are good at that everywhere. Here though, it comes in a different form, like everything. So it's like they've got everybody. So they've got the free, you know, the Moreno houses. They've promised poor people that they're going to raise welfare from $50 to $150 a month, which and then of course Lasso makes the point that, you know, any thinking person would make that would said, you know, guys, they've had 10 years to give you a free house and raise welfare from $50 to $150 a month. Why are they announcing it now? But, you know, they're really good at that class warfare. They're really good at convincing people, you know, this guy who's going to give you all this free stuff has your interests in mind. And this guy, other guy who wants to sort of leave you alone and let you live your life and work, you know, doesn't. And I just think that's really, you know, it's interesting and it's unfortunate. And it's just very on display. You just have a lot of folks, I really believe, truly, you know, just voting against their own interests. I mean, raising welfare is not, if you're on welfare and they're now giving you more money, that's not going to help you in your life. Yeah, you might, you know, get a little more food and, you know, might have some more things. You can buy more things, but you're ultimately dependent on government then for the rest of your life. And if you go get a job, they take your welfare away. So, you know, the idea that, you know, you can live on $150, which is nothing, obviously, you know, a month from the government for the rest of your life, is that help, you know, your journey as a human being? I would obviously argue definitely not. So, and no one's getting any free houses or anything like that. So it's just a sham. It's just a charade. But it's very interesting to watch it play out.
Absolutely. Anything else?
No, I'm good, man. It was a long show. Let's get out of here. I got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, same here, actually. an appointment that we were starting at 10. I told the person I'll be there at 11:30 because I thought we'd wrap up in an hour, but now I'm already running late, so good. Well, thanks again for joining us for the Ecuador Insider Podcast. Again, we're Abundant and Living Ecuador, a real estate and relocation services firm based in Loja, Ecuador. You can reach us from Canada toll-free at 1-888-999-0948. You can reach us via email at info@abecuador.com. That's A as in Apple, B as in Boy, Ecuador.com. Also, make sure to follow us on all of our social media platforms, particularly YouTube. A lot of great videos coming out to inform you about all things Ecuador. So thanks again for joining us, and tune in again next week.